Thanks for tuning into this earnings conversation. When COVID-19 first hit us, businesses were thinking that they'll get disrupted. And at that point of time, one of India's largest life insurance companies had come and said that COVID could actually turn out to be an inflection point for the industry at large. Well, the question to Ms. Vibha Padalkar of HDFC Life as she joins us today is whether quarter two is testimony to that belief then, and can things change materially from here on as well. Ms. Padalkar, good having you. Thanks so much for joining in. How do you map the quarter? Because as I look at the quarter, it has a lot of positives and a couple of things that I would want to quiz you about. But how do you look at it overall?
We're fairly pleased at the way quarter two has panned out. Only metric really, Neeraj. But if I were to look at the new business growth, we have seen an overall growth in our business of 22%. On the back of that growth, we've seen market share expansion close to 350 basis points to 17%. And this is way ahead of industry degrowth. So against a degrowth of about 3%. Also, if I were to look at renewal premium, that has been about 20%. If I were to look at protection, if I were to look at annuity business, that has also done very well. If I were to look at our margins are higher than Q2 margins of last year. So the so-called post-COVID versus pre-COVID impact is something, again, we are fairly happy in terms of 0.2% NBM expansion that we have seen. Persistency, 13-month persistency has done better. I think the scorecard all around has been something that I think we are reasonably satisfied with.
Yeah, I mean, 91% on 13-month is quite stellar. But just wondering, this market share expansion, is it a factor of the innovative product strategy? Is it a factor of, I know you will say it's a combination of all, but I'm still trying to figure out where is the main thing. Is it innovative products? Is it the distribution strength? Or is it the brand name?
I'll try and not say all of the above, but I think what has come to our rescue or is our competitive advantage, I think, is balance. The fact that we've always believed in balanced product mix and balanced distribution mix meant that all our eggs were not in any basket. And so we were where the customer was. We were selling in the way that made sense for the customer, and also selling things that were topical to both the customer and the partner in ways that were non-face-to-face. So all of that kind of came together in quarter two. Quarter one was also good, but quarter two was even better. So these combinations, so even when you look at our stated objectives of selling more of protection and retirement-led products like annuity, that has grown. Our bank assurance has grown, as well as our online channel. Our agency has finally shown positive growth of 6%. So really, we're firing on several cylinders.
Yeah, and you know, I know it might be imprudent to look at something like market share, which is so fickle on such a short time frame as well. But I would want to understand from you that would you reckon that what you've done in quarter in terms of market share, because frankly, when I looked at all the parameters, the one that stood out for me was market share. Would you reckon that that advantage, as you have gotten it, is sustainable? Can you say that it is sustainable, or is it difficult to say that?
So we don't chase market share, you mentioned the word fickle, and we believe in a couple of things. One is our growth needs to be industry growth, and second is our growth needs to be profitable growth. What happens thereafter on market share is an outcome, but that's not the objective. It's nice to be, now we're number two in the private space, it's nice to be there even on top line, but that's not how our scorecard reads.
No, sorry, please make your point.
Yeah, you know, it once starts chasing market share, then it can get to be a slippery slope in terms of how much of underwriting risks that one is prepared to take, how much of risks that one is prepared to take on your investment book, and so on. So it has to be wherein it has to fit within the risk parameters that have been set by the board, and then you see what best you can do under those circumstances.
Sure. I remember a conversation that we had wherein you had said that, you know, you want to talk. I mean, you hope that the industry doesn't go down that path. I'm sure you won't. Okay. Just, Just a couple of hygiene questions, Ms. Padalkar. I read as the takeaways from your call that my analyst forum gave me that 95% of the policies are made through the online mode. Please correct me if I'm wrong here. But if that is indeed the case, that speaks of some digital prowess that you have, which could be unmatched in nature. Now, my question is that an advantage that will stay good for the better part of the next 12, 18, 6 months, what have you? And does that keep you in good stead for continuing what you've done in quarter two?
You know, frankly, I would be a little bit more pragmatic, and it will go down to whether it's 75% or some such number. I still think that there is a place for digital way of doing business, and it will be a happy combination of both. It can also be like, for example, today we see on online wherein prospective customers fill in their form and look it up themselves up to a point, and then they drop off, and then maybe somebody calls them. There is some hand holding, and then you see the closure of the sale. I can see that happening a lot more than just saying digital will rule, but it will be a combination of both. And we find that our traditional channels also, like agency and broker, are beginning to embrace digital, but it's not going to replace face to face.
Especially post COVID. Yeah, the reason why I actually was asking is because in a conversation we had immediately post COVID, I think you had mentioned that some of the things are getting impacted because people are not, your people are not going to go out, able to go out in the field and try and meet people. So I was wondering if 95% is online, then how did that shape up? And therefore, if this is starting off now, when people are able to go to the field, does it enhance the prospect of being able to complete the final sale?
It certainly does. And especially higher ticket sizes. What you see on online is easier for lower ticket sizes. But when somebody's committing a higher ticket size, and this is not a one-year product like, say, the general insurance sector. If someone's doing that and he has to pay premiums for the next 10, 15, 20 years, then he does want that human interaction often. And also to clear some doubts that he might have. Insurance can become quite complicated, and that's when the both in person and a combination of digital comes in very handy.
Okay, a bit about products. I presume Sanjay Par is doing very well. You've also, unless I'm very wrong, filed an application for a new product in the protection segment. Can you talk a bit about that?
Yes, certainly. Yes, Sanjay Par Advantage is doing very well, and it is today about a third of our business in terms of the par segment. Sanjay Plus, our flagship non-par savings products, that also continues to do very well at about 30% of our business. The new kid on the block, which is Group Purn Suraksha, which is a pure protection product under the group umbrella. So wherein we might have a lot of marquee customers, marquee corporates that we have, and their employees or homogeneous population that they deal with, we can sell our term policies under the group platform to them. So that's currently on, and engagements with a lot of corporates is on. The first step is enrollment and convincing the corporate to do this, and what's in it for me, a conversation that's going on currently. But we expect to see a very steady pickup in this segment as well.
And then the
new kid on the block is we've just got the go ahead for Corona cover. So that too will start getting some level of focus.
And you reckon the protection share would continue to move higher? I presume it's at 9% in the first half.
Yes, correct. It's 9%. It was 6% first half of last year. But the way we drive it is lesser in terms of what percentage of our total it should be, because sometimes savings products do well and we expect savings to come back onto the radar, especially as COVID starts receding. So we see it also in terms of what is my standalone protection growth, and standalone individual protection growth has been 38%. And that's the number we track on an absolute basis, as well as what is the percentage contribution to total. Both are important.
Okay. Last two, three questions, Ms. Padalkar. One is, since we are on the protection and the standard on the plan, how will this launch of a standard plan impact? I'm just trying to understand from the dynamics, because you've been at the forefront of product innovation, and I presume that has held very well for you. So does this kind of negate that, despite the strong brand equity that you have?
No, the standard term product is something that we welcome. This is very similar to the standard plain vanilla product that we have at our core in our term products anyway. Why this is easier for us is that there is a 45-day cooling off period. That helps in terms of weeding out anti-selection, especially for the lower sum assureds, the 25 lakhs and below. We have in the past tried to access and cover these segments, but often the level of medical underwriting and so on is prohibitive at very small levels of premium. Now, with this waiting period, it at least helps us in ruling out some of these anti-selection practices. So we are reasonably happy about trying this out and launching this.
So effectively, just to understand this, all it does is add one more product in your bouquet, which would be homogeneous with others. And it depends on how well your brand helps you sell it.
Absolutely. Because the pricing will be different. And it'll depend on what kind of underwriting practices, how much of hoops that do you make a person go through for medicals and other KYC documents and so on. But yes, the terms and conditions will be plain vanilla. Reason why we are reasonably happy about this, apart from the waiting period, is that people who are, you know, not yet sure, they're somewhat diffident, you know, to say this is too complex, I don't know. Maybe they'll just start the journey somewhere. Hopefully move up the ladder in terms of protecting themselves at higher sums assured.
Okay. One final question, Ms. Padalkar. When I look at corporate India in the first half, a lot of corporates have done very innovative cost-cutting measures, have cut down costs either by cutting flab or, you know, SGN has come off, etc., and which has helped them throw up good margins. One, what's your experience out there, and do you reckon that what you've posted in the first half could sustain or improve? That is part one of my question. Part two of my question is, there is this other prism of companies who are saying that I don't want to go down that route because right now I don't want to let a good crisis go to waste, and I want to go out and gain market share, even if it means that my margins take a bit of a hit. It doesn't matter. Which school of thought are you in currently, and what do you think the second half does versus the first half?
I think it's a hybrid between the two. So discretionary spending is something that we've had a tight control on. But at the same time, investments in technology, especially in digital, is something that we have not held back. That is, I think, very important. And you know, just on the cusp of COVID, we went live on cloud. Without that backbone, we would have not been able to roll out a lot of offerings that we have been able to. So while our expense ratio has gone down from 14% to about 11-odd%, I will see that 11-odd% beginning to rise a little bit, still much less than last year, but nevertheless slightly higher. And the reason is that it will be a combination of the discretionary expenditure that has been held back, as well as the necessary expenditure. So I am on the school of thought that it's somewhat easier to cut costs very significantly, but it can start hurting the business when you see the upside coming through. And one needs to be in a pole position to be able to catch demand when you start seeing green shoots. So cutting too far, I would not subscribe to that that school of thought.
Fabulous. Are you seeing green shoots, Ms. Padalkar?
Oh, absolutely. Absolutely, we're seeing when I look at every metric, whether sum assured, when I look at number of policies, the 4.4 lakh policies that we have sold on the back of 6% growth, when I look at protection annuity that we talked about, when I also look at the number of agents that we have added, we are amongst the top three in the private space. So all of that means that these agents that we've added will start firing. If not in quarter three, but certainly in quarter two by the time we end this financial year. So the building blocks are certainly in place for us to take advantage of opportunity as it unfolds.
Well, all the best for that, Ms. Padalkar. Thank you so much for speaking to us, and most importantly, stay safe.
You too. Thank you so much.
Yeah, pleasure is ours.
Thanks. Yeah, thanks.
And viewers, thanks for tuning in to this edition of the Earnings Conversation with HDFC Life.